This is silly. Hello, Ferret. Hello, Squeaky. Hello, whoever else might be lurking. I am alive. What a shame. I got a, distracting text message a moment ago. Nothing life-threatening, but, something I've been waiting on for a while, so if I suddenly have to stop and pay attention to text messages, then I apologize. Hopefully everything will be alright. So this camera is way too close. Let's use the magic of... There we go! You can see the top of my coif. Wait, that's... where do you start with something like this? So when I was a kid, a friend brought the Player's Handbook. I guess this was in, let's say this was 7th grade? I want to say this was 7th grade. My friend brought in Player's Handbook and the Forgotten Realms 2nd edition campaign setting into school. He said, "Hey guys, I got this. Do you want to play?" And I was like, "I don't know what that is." But oddly enough, I did know what the TSR Dungeons & Dragons based card game was. We'd been playing Spellfire for a little while, I think. We had started off... I didn't get into Magic the Gathering in high school or, you know, the thing. Middle school, excuse me. I didn't get into Magic the Gathering. I learned how to play it, but already I was feeling like, oh, I'm gonna have to buy really expensive cards in order to win at this game. And then I went back to it in grad school, and it turned out that wasn't the case, and I had a lot of fun with it. But in middle school, we played the Star Wars card game, which was way too complicated, and... Don't even get me started, Ferret. Do not even get me started. We played the Star Wars card game, which is too complicated, and then we played a card game entirely based around dragons called Wyvern, and that was okay. It actually wasn't that great, but I was willing to forgive a certain amount of it because it was based around dragons, and I like dragons a lot, and always have. And always will. That... hopefully is true. And then we've been playing Spellfire for some reason, probably just because it was available. I grew up in Key West, Florida, where you couldn't necessarily always get a lot of good game stuff or a lot of good anything. And so you sort of had to deal with what it is that you could find. And we could find that. And then at a certain point... Squeaky, thank you for the host. At a certain point... the local Walden Books started to carry role-playing game stuff, and sure enough, my friend got Forgotten Realms, and he got the Player's Handbook, and we ran the introductory campaign, or not even campaign, just a short adventure. I played a wizard, a level 1 wizard, with, I want to say the max hit points you could have at level 1 as a wizard in 2nd edition was 4. And that I had like 2 hit points. It was not ideal, but we were interested. And that friend actually wound up writing his own like homebrew sci-fi campaign that I played in. We had a number of friends that played in it. And then I played... he moved away. He was a Navy kid. And so his family moved. And, but that was right around the time when America Online got big. And, I played in his campaign. Before he moved, actually, I'm getting way ahead of myself. I discovered that there were other settings out there, and I began to collect, and I finally stumbled across one that really caught my eye. I was like, you know what, I'm going to actually give this a try. And that friend and a couple other friends all rolled up characters, and we did the introductory the adventure, and it was not Eberron, Squeaky, thank you, but it was not. I love Eberron. I played Eberron in college, an undergraduate. I would love to run an Eberron campaign sometime, maybe if and when Dark Sun ever wraps up, or if I start something else, because I've got the time to run two online campaigns, don't I? I don't have any time. I can't run the one. I'm in over my head. I have so much debt. No, of course, Dark Sun was the one, and this was the box. This is not the exact box, but this is the same, and it's in very, very good condition, and it has pretty much everything in it, and I got it off eBay, and we're going to look at all the wonderful stuff that's inside, and it's not going to spoil anything that's going on in our ongoing campaign, but it will maybe help illustrate a little bit of why I love this setting quite so much, at least at the very beginning. Oh. Give me a moment. I have to take this call. Be right back.
Hello.
It was my mom. She's doing great. I missed, we usually talk once a week, and we didn't talk on Monday. And, she was calling me back. Which is sweet. But I told her, Mom, I'm on a stream. And she said, oh, okay, that's fine. She's great. Polo? Where'd you go? Hello! Found a dragon. Good dog. Not sure if that one's invincible or not, but knowing Polo, that won't stop him. Hi, Hampton! Oh man, how's it going? It is totally happening, my friend. So yeah, this is not the box that I grew up with. This is not the childhood copy. I gave that to a friend. I believe maybe when he was getting deployed to go to Iraq. And I don't think he took that with him, but I think that he took a player's handbook. And it turned out someone else had brought the monster manual with them, and so they were waiting to invade Iraq, and they were just waiting, and then they discovered that they all like Dungeons & Dragons, and they were thinking of getting a campaign going. And then instead, we cleared war and we invaded Iraq. Ridiculous. Polo! Which, you know, I don't begrudge him, but certainly now I wish I had hung on to it. But that's okay, because now I have a new copy, and actually this is probably in even better condition than my own copy would have been anyway. So this is the expanded and revised edition, and it's got this sort of different middle of the sunburst kind of logo. If you see all kinds of things blowing up on my phone. If you look at, do I have the actual logo here somewhere? The other logo that I've sort of shown off from time to time. I've got to have something that's got it plastered across it somewhere here. Hang on. This logo is the original Dark Sun logo, which is, to be honest, kind of the better looking one of the two. But this distinguishes that this is the original release of Dark Sun, which happened earlier in Second Edition's timeline. And then, I don't think that it was entirely for story reasons, but there were some story reasons that they wanted to unleash some new stuff, but they also wanted to show off different parts of the world. And sure enough, we got this update, which has tons and tons of information. It has tons and tons of expanded material. It greatly, greatly broadens the scope of the world, which was really interesting to me. And it's also, to be frank, got way better interior artwork. Like, a lot of, there's this artist named Brom, B-R-O-M, who did a lot of the conceptual work that appears on the covers of a lot of the Dark Sun stuff, and a lot of the interior stuff is, you know, not bad. Actually, this particular one that I happened to grab looks very, very good because, well, not because, but it happens to share, I can put it here and you can see a lot better, as a matter of fact. This art figures very, very prominently, this art style, rather, figures very prominently in the Planescape Second Edition stuff, which looked incredible, and it had way more, like, adornment and, accessory to it than Dark Sun necessarily did, because Dark Sun is, you know, sort of a lower tech, people are generally poorer kind of place. Oh, here we go. So I'm not an artist myself, and so it's not my call necessarily to belittle people for what they can do, but this particular piece, you know, there's some weird perspective, and it's okay. It'll do. Button here, just generally the quality of art is just, like, tremendous. Even just look at this business on the top. It's got a lot of what you'd expect to see. You've got this gigantic sand serpent, and there's, like, a lizard man riding on top, and there's a mull and a thrycreen fighting, and there's a druid back there in the back, and he's got, like, a lizard arm or something like that, and there's some ruins, and there's some weird light, and it's great! Well, let's look at the back. That was my, I'm flipping it over to the back. It's really just sort of a list of the stuff that you can find in there. Let me read you the flavor stuff. A decade has passed since the Age of Heroes began. The city of Tyre is broken free of tyranny through turmoil. Turmoil still holds the world in its merciless grip. Some other story stuff that isn't relevant to us. Giant rifts pierce this once impenetrable land far to the north. The alien Thrycreen Empire quickens, sensing its opportunity to invade, and to the south in the obsidian wasteland, the ground stirs with the emergence of undead. Welcome to a world where metal is scarce, gods don't exist, and psionic powers abide in all living creatures. This significantly expanded and revised box set contains everything you need to adventure across the burning lands of Athos. Suggested retail price, $30. And this was published in 1995. I believe most of the original stuff comes from 91, 92, so this is really not that much longer afterwards. Yeah. Let's see what's inside. Oh, what's that on top? Hi, Kempetti. Very Dev, you know perfectly well that there are loads of traps. This This is way better than a human head. It's upside down. It's a cloth map of the Tablelands. Look at that mess. I don't know if you could appreciate like the material, but it's this cool parchment color. And it's all like, it's linen. It's probably linen. Oh, man. Look at this. How great is that? Oh, man. So you can pick out some of the places where we've been. This map is just a little different than the 4th edition map, which I usually use as gospel. But most of the important stuff is in the exact same place. This is Alterac here, and the Ringing Mountains are over here, and there's Tyre, and then there's, you know, beyond that, the Forest Ridge. And actually up here you can see the Hinterlands, the Dragon Crown Mountains, and the weird forest in the middle of it. And then if you go all the way up here, there's Yarramuk and Ram, and all the way down here is actually Nibene's name is kind of smudged out. That's kind of funny. Oh man. It's so great. Look at this big silt sea. Look at this. It's terrific. It is absolutely terrific. And this is actually, I am more excited about the other map stuff in there, but flavor-wise, this is terrific. I love this. I love every bit of it. Let's look at just maybe a little bit of the stuff where places where you haven't gone yet. There's down here, there's the city-state of Balak. Balak. And gosh, what are there? There's all kinds of ruins up above there, and there's the Great Ivory Plain that's sort of near Nibene and Gulg. And there's all kinds of stuff off to the west. There's, oh man, it's good, it's good. But you know what? We're going to see even more when we look at the other map that's included in here, which I'm even more excited about. Where'd the box go? It's over here. Hey, that's a great question, Squeaky. There are the Hinterlands, which we've been to, which are generally kind of empty. And there's some space beyond that. Well, heck, I could tell you. Why don't I show you? Okay. I'm actually going to take this camera and like lift it up because you need to be able to appreciate the scope of this thing. So this is the same area, but the area that we were just looking at sort of encompassed about that size of the map. Look at all of the other stuff that they put out here. There's this chain of volcanic islands with ruins and stuff out there. There's this mysterious vortex out in the middle of the Sea of Silt. There's another great salt flat down here. I love salt, it's great. And there's all these ruins sort of peppered across, and there's this massive just sheet of obsidian down to the south. It's like Antarctica, but dead. And there's all this stuff, so I don't know if I can push this and not screw everything up, but if you look, here's the Hinterlands, there's the Dragon Crown Mountains that we were just looking at. There's a little bit of stuff. Here's the Terran village where our heroes stopped off, but then past that, there's this interesting sort of rift, and there's this whole span over here. Might be all kinds of stuff hidden in there. And then what's really exciting is you follow this road, you go through all the Tablelands, but then if you venture past Rom and past distant Draj, and you take this road all the way up, all the way up, all the way up, and go north. There's a whole other map. Doubling the size of the world. So that road goes up here, up here, up here, up here. As a matter of fact, we've seen a little bit of this particular map in a cutscene presented by one Leonine Sorcerer King, as a matter of fact. There's the city-state of Kern over here, but also there's Eldritch over here. But then beyond that, you've got this tremendous area, this volcanic area here, the Lava Gorge. You've got the Bandit States down here. You've got the Glowing Desert. You've got this... Is there a giant lake or something like that? And there's like another separate forest sort of down here. You can sort of see it. You can sort of see it there. City-state of Khorne. You are just... You're tremendous. And then if you get really far, there's almost an even bigger... Like, there's a huge body of water up here. Far north, far away from the Sorcerer Kings. And then, remember, this is that... there's that ridge that went all the way down the hinterlands. And now that stretch that I was sort of gesturing to has roads and cities in it. What is going on in there? Who lives here? Who lives in the Jagged Cliffs region that's marked in such large text? There's so much stuff up here. It's terrific. Oh, man. Now, as I mentioned, I had this when I was a kid, and I've read about Dark Sun ever since. And so certainly a lot of that has been in my head. So this is not necessarily new information as far as... as far as our ongoing campaign, The Ancient Sands, goes. But, sorry, I just got that text message. Let me just respond to it really quick. Okay. Anyway, stuff that I knew about, but is that much more concrete and just exciting to have. I can't wait to put this on my wall. It's gonna be right there, and I'm gonna see it every day, and it's gonna inspire that much more adventure. Speaking of adventure, what would a campaign setting be if it didn't come with an adventure? Mystery of the Ancients is a fun little trip. These aren't necessarily spoilers for the campaign. This is good music for this. These aren't campaign spoilers, but these are, this is sort of a glimpse into the way that the Dungeon Master's mind works. This is sort of a look into the toolbox, if you will. The toolbox. So if you don't want your mind blown, what might happen to be in here, I advise you to shut off your device right now. The table of contents. No, you don't need to run away. I don't think this will be a tremendous surprise in any way. Mystery of the Ancients is a beginning adventure for level 1 characters. Oh, man. So this jumps ahead a little bit, but one of the things that Dark Sun is famed for is its deadliness. I mean, we've certainly seen a particular character die once before, but it was, you know, it was still second edition. Like I mentioned, when I played as a level 1 wizard in the Forgotten Realms adventure, I had 2 hit points. You're exactly right, Squeaky. If you rolled up a new character in this game, you had to start at level 3, because otherwise you simply weren't going to cut it. Which means that the introductory adventure is a level 3 adventure. Anyway, this is a beginner's adventure, just for some new characters out on the streets trying to figure out what to do with their lives. And it happens to involve the Overcouncil of Tyre giving them a commission to take some Terran traders back to their home across the Ringing Mountains. And as a matter of fact, it has Telak Goldeye. It has some chaotic adventures in the Ringing Mountains. And it's got some good stuff. It's got some... It's got a little bit of pomp and flair you wouldn't necessarily expect in some spots where... there's like a competition to see who is going to be the party takes on, or excuse me, which adventuring party gets to take on the mission. It does not have a lich. No, it does not have a lich. So this is one example of which there are many, many more, where I took a pre-established adventure and adapted it to our needs. I knew that I wanted the party to adventure sort of west while we were in Tyre, because it was a good opportunity for that. And there's not many chances to do that above and beyond that. Sorry, let me just take care of this. This is... got someone helping me procure a birthday present for someone. They actually went to the store and bought it and are probably going to wrap it for me. In the middle of something just now. There, good. Sorry about that. Anyway, and this was, you know, not necessarily the only reason that they were headed that way, but it was a very, very convenient kind of side kind of thing to tack on to this idea of like, hey, you can make some money. I mean, you guys haven't made any money yet. You need to go back to Tyre and collect. But there was a lot of kind of events and stuff like that to tie in. This is some of the higher grade kind of artwork that I'm talking about. This is a halfling that's consumed by a symbiote type monster of some kind, perhaps in sort of a strange city found deep within the jungle. That kind of thing. One of the things that always bugged me is that this adventure has, like, a couple of seeds of, like, oh, here's some stuff that we're going to try and do sometime in the near future. And unfortunately, they didn't really do a whole lot with that. They came out with a lot of great, great supplements for revised second edition, but they didn't do any more adventures, which was too bad, because that particular adventure was a big step forward for their Dark Sun adventure writing stuff. Some of the old ones are not very good. I like a lot of the Dark Sun published material. The adventures... What else we got? A bunch of books. We have... Oh man, I forgot there's so much great stuff in here. The Way of the Psionicist. Psionic Abilities and Powers. So, one of the things that Dark Sun is all about is like... Oh, well, magic is weird and there's no gods, but we sort of balance it out by giving everyone psionic powers. And some people can actually specialize in psionics. And this is sort of a revised... So I believe that they had done a... yes, they did the Complete Psionics Handbook. And it's interesting. It has its own sort of system, and they do a good job of coming up with, like, a distribution of how these things work. There's point values, and you get sort of a pool of points, and you have disciplines that you can focus on, and disciplines can be different things like displacement, or telepathy, or like body enhancement, stuff like making you go super fast, or suddenly being super strong. Through the force of your will alone! And I think that they did a pretty decent job of working with what they had. Given that, it's you gotta know what it is that you want out of it. And certainly there's a lot of different things that you can do. There's a lot of reading. I have not to date seen a psionics implementation that I really liked. I like to a certain extent that you can sort of just make... I'm okay with the idea of it not necessarily being a completely separate system. What is this? This is just like... All this is, it's like a bunch of gourds and like a tongue hanging down. Peculiar. Actually, there seem to be like more weapons and stuff like that. Maybe just because they have the art hanging around. So this is, there's some more. This is like a little axe. Put it in the middle. That's neat. Oh, and then there's the gourds and the tongue. It's weird. So, this is neat. Maybe this is the least exciting thing in the box. Certainly, I should probably take another look at it. Psionics haven't played into our campaign in a huge way so far. I'm kind of fine with that, since no one in the party has been especially excited about the idea of working with psionics. So I don't feel a need to like force it on people, necessarily. Still, maybe something to be found there. What else we got? Oh, man! Dungeon Master screen. This has some more neat artwork. Now, it doesn't have, like, the big montage-type scenes that a lot of modern Dungeon Master screens have. Actually, I prefer mine quite a bit more. But this one, excuse me, is quite nice. As far as I know, it's the only official Dark Sun campaign screen, or Dungeon Master screen, that's ever been created. But it's got sort of this big panoramic picture of these ruins. Actually, this scene is kind of interesting in that it has monsters that I'm not familiar with. I actually don't know what these... I mean, obviously these are giant bees, but I don't remember big giant bees, at least of this size, in Dark Sun necessarily. Perhaps these are halflings riding them or something like that. Maybe this is just one of the many myriad things that you can find out in the jungle. And these giant, like, sand snake kind of things, I'm not familiar with those either, which certainly, you know, Dark Sun, it makes sense that there would just be giant bees and giant snakes somewhere out there. But, I don't know. It seems like there's a lot more iconic stuff that they might be able to have there, but... And on the back, all these great, juicy, little, crunchy, second edition tables. Base mental armor class and PSP bonuses. PSP being, like, psionic points. I think. Oh, there's M-Thaco. Thaco? M-Thaco. Remember Thaco? 2-hit armor class 0. That's how you play. And in fact, there's a whole Thaco table right here for you. All kinds of stuff. What else we got here? We got the saving throws. Remember, there are 5 categories of saving throws in 2nd edition. Paralyzation, poison, or death magic. That's the first one. Rod, staff, or wand. Petrification or polymorph. Breath weapon or spell. Ridiculous. What else do we have on here? Ridiculous. Here's a custom table specifically for how good elves can run. Or what the leader bonus is from a mass elf run. Remember, elves are very fast and like running. A mull exertion table. That's pretty Dark Sun, right? That's a thing. Oh, here's some money. You know, it's just a table to tell you how money works. Oh, man. So one thing that I did not like is the weird, like, conversion that you're supposed to do if you're playing Dark Sun in 2nd edition and you're like, okay, this is a metal poor world and everything has ceramic pieces. So... what do we do? And so what they did is they just made everyone in the party poorer. But if you found a non-metal item that it cost 1% of what it would cost as priced in the player's handbook, but all metal items cost what you would find, and it was simply harder to get that much money. So in Forgotten Realms, if it cost 10 gold to get a steel sword, no magical bonuses or anything like that, then it still cost 10 gold in Dark Sun, but that was like a noble's ransom. Like, no one would see that much gold in their entire life. But most people wouldn't see a single gold. And it would be, like, incontrovertibly difficult to save up that much, because someone would just kill you or rob you or something like that. Okay, here's a couple more interesting tables. There's Athasian weapons. If it doesn't autofocus out. Some of the weird kind of little pieces of weaponry that we've seen sort of in the margins here. A lot of them have their own names. Just more of the flavor. And then there's a specific table for Defiler Magical Destruction. As different terrain types, then spell levels. And then if you match those up, you get the radius in yards around the defiler where all vegetation is turned to ash. Handy. Currency, I much prefer the, I much prefer the 4th edition implementation, where they basically just say everything costs the same, and it's strictly a flavor type thing. Because doing that conversion or that kind of bookkeeping stinks. It's such a pain in the ass. Metal weapons function normally. Typical Dark Sun weapons, because they're not made of metal, would have a chance to break. Which, I believe, is one of the many rules included in the Age of Heroes. Rules for conquering the savage land. The big old rule book that tells you what makes this character, or excuse me, this setting, that much better. Opens up, as most of the player handbooks do, with all of the weird and wonderful races that you can get. There's like twice as many races, at least in 2nd edition. In this, you get the Arakakro, which are the birdmen, like Kirkata, we've met him. He's a guy. You've got the weird elves that are big and tall and like running and no one trusts them. And there's half-giants, and there's halflings that like to eat people. There's mulls that are super strong and super durable. And there's Terrans. Terrans are a playable race, like Telak Goldeye. They're like pterodactyls, only walking. And there's Thrycreen. Everyone likes Thrycreen. They're great. Just so much in the way of just stuff that you can do. And then there are all these different sort of tweaks and modifications to say, like, hey, here's how this particular thing works in the Dark Sun universe. And actually, they added a whole other class. They added gladiators as a whole class. I mean, I think that was kind of a clumsy way to do it. I much prefer, like, kits or specializations and stuff like that. I don't think there was a need to do that. But, you know, they tried. They were figuring out what to do. And who can really blame them for that? Wizard classes, likewise, there are defilers and preservers as separate classes. You didn't play a wizard, you played a defiler or you played a preserver. It was like paladins and anti-paladins. What is this table here? This is game effects of preserving and defiling magic. Oh man, look at that! Look at all this huge page of rules for the effects on the vegetation. If you choose to cast arcane magic in the Dark Sun world, that is, understand, even when I was running this as a dungeon master, when it was, like, relevant, when I was in middle school, like, this would have been 98 or 99 or something like that. Maybe not even that, maybe 97. So this stuff would have only been a couple of years old. But even then, I was like, you know what? The fact that you gave me this page, I really appreciate that. but I'm not going to use that. I'm going to use something called my imagination. And I'm just going to move on from there. Priests are elemental based. Actually, this artwork here is kind of cool, where each of the, there's four sort of in each corner, and each one, it's a little Avatar airbender type of stuff, where you've got one of each different type of element kind of going at it. Not bad. And then you've got some druids, and druids are fun, and you've got bards, who no one trusts, and they're poisonous. And, you know, just all the staples. Oh, man, and they added a trader class? Why would they want a trader class? Because going and trading with people is so much fun. It's so great to go and just bargain with stuff. Actually, the Dune Trader supplement from the earlier Dark Sun stuff had rules for, like, hey, if your players are interested in just being merchants for this game, then here is the kind of structure you might want to use for a game based around that. And I really like that idea. I really like the idea of just, okay, well, we're in Dark Sun, but it's not going to be necessarily combat and dungeon exploring. It's just going to be, how do we live our lives? And then Psionicist was its own class, of course, where you've got people and they're trying to think monsters, but the other guy's thinking really hard, and he's got, like, a big tower around his brain. Oh, man. Hi, MacManaman7. We're exploring the second edition campaign setting of Dark Sun. It came out in 1995. Yes, exactly that kind of trader, Squeaky. Merchants of the finest caliber. Oh, man. Okay, so here's another rule. Character trees. Character trees were one of the hallmarks of the original. Here it is an optional rule. Polo. Dark Sun campaigns are set in a violent world. Powerful magic and psionics, desperate hordes of raiders, and the unforgiving environment conspire against player characters. This makes death a very real possibility for player characters. To offset this, in Dark Sun campaigns, players are encouraged to use character trees. Although they play with only one character at a time, they have four to call upon at the beginning of any particular game session, thus minimizing the time needed to start a game after a PC's death. So, you have these characters, and because it's a given that one of them is probably going to die, you've already got three other characters that you're at least semi-invested in that you can go do stuff with, and they're not necessarily, like, you can't send them on side quests when you're not using them, but they're available in the wings, as it were, for you to switch over to in the event that, you know, your character gets eaten by a giant centipede. Oh, man. Okay. So here, we're really getting into some of the specifics. So this is the proficiencies chapter. The proficiencies used to be everything. So there's some stuff here that is adapted from the base game, bureaucracy and bargain and stuff like that. There's some stuff that is very clearly Dark Sun based, which is heat protection, contact. Contact is a proficiency for psionicists and psionic wild talents, which is described in full in the other book. Water find, mental armor. Oh, somatic concealment. The spellcasters can mumble verbal components and hide material components in their hands and robes. Somatic components are harder to hide. The somatic component of any spell, which is the weird hand gesturing type of thing that you have to do sometimes in order to cast a magical spell, is apparent to any character watching the spellcaster. On Athys, where spellcasting is often illegal, the ability to hide the necessary gestures becomes important. If movements can be concealed, a spell can be unleashed without calling attention to the caster. So you can use this proficiency, and you use DM makes a check. So this is entirely in the check. I certainly prefer the fourth edition implementation, which is what we use, which is the caster makes a check, and then I make an opposed check in order to see if anyone spots it or not. And so on and so forth. Money and equipment. Money and equipment. It's a pain. It is such a pain. There's all these rules about bartering. There's the Merchant's Code. It's got the entirety of the Merchant's Code. They really want you to give some consideration to the idea of, like, hey... Oh, here's descriptions of all of the, like, weird Dark Sun weapon types and stuff like that. This is good. I'll probably read through that. I haven't been using those quite as much. I would like to. So having those handy would be nice. Armor. It is not... Well, it is a... It's a Thunderbird coffee shirt, unfortunately. which is a local coffee joint. All forms of armor listed in the player's handbook are available to the 1,000 characters, though the high price of metal and the extreme heat make metal armor less than desirable on Athos. A suit of field plate armor costs 2,000 gold on Athos, the equivalent of 200,000 gold on other AD&D campaign worlds. Simply put, a Sorcerer King can either purchase several suits of field plate or build a substantial addition to his city walls. And if you're wearing that, then you're gonna die from heat stroke because you're encased in metal and it's 150 degrees outside. One thing that I really liked was they had this idea of piecemeal armor. It wasn't super well implemented, and like a lot of these other things, it was kind of a pain in the ass to keep track of. But there was this idea of, like, okay, I'm just gonna collect bits and pieces and, like, make this sort of makeshift assembly of armor based on whatever I can scrounge or whatever I can find. And so it says, like, okay, if I have chain and I have the breastplate and it's only chain, then I get 2 points from that. And maybe I've got one arm of banded mail and I've got one arm of leather armor and it gets put together that way. It's a really neat idea, and I think whenever I think of a Dark Sun player character, I always imagine them almost always in that sort of assembly, kind of scrounged material type stuff anyway. What do we got? Magic and spells. Look at all this. We've got so many different... So this sort of talks about the differences of this... Yeah, it's very Fallout. It's extremely, extremely Fallout. Dark Sun is absolutely a post-apocalyptic kind of world. It's just a Dungeons and Dragons post-apocalyptic world. So this sort of lists some new stuff, but mostly it lists, hey, there's all these spells that you're probably familiar with from regular Dungeons and Dragons in the Player's Handbook. Here's how some of them are different. For example, here's Ice Storm. We're familiar with Ice Storm. In Dark Sun campaigns, the water, hail, and ice created by the spell is only temporary. If you drink it, it disappears. Because if you give players a spell that generates water, then the world is just that much less deadly. And there's some custom items, particularly some psionic stuff. There's some really interesting kind of defiler and preserver type stuff. Here's some notes on how to roleplay the different races and how to... award experience appropriately. Let's look at one. Let's look at the half-giant. Adopting the lifestyles of others gives a half-giant purpose. As a player character, half-giant... So, backtracking really quick. Let's... No, I don't believe there's a jug of endless water. Let's backtrack really quick, because this is something that's I've always really liked about half-giants, and that I don't know that Lobos knew going in, but the way that he's played Marcus has just... synced up with it really nicely, so I'm starting down here. Read along if you've got it. Half-giants switch attitudes very quickly, taking on new values to fit new situations. This malleable attitude is handled by a changing alignment. A half-giant character selects one aspect of his alignment to remain fixed at the time the character is created. So either lawful, chaotic, or good or evil or neutral or something like that. The other aspect is determined at the start of each day of game time. The character is bound to that alignment combination until he sleeps and wakes again. For example, if a half-giant has a fixed good side, then each morning he chooses, theoretically, to be lawful good, neutral good, or chaotic good. Half-giant psionicists must have a fixed da-da-da-da. Although this alignment change isn't mandatory, it should certainly be provoked in role-playing situations as a reaction to extreme changes in a half-giant's environment. A half-giant's nature is to switch his alignment aspect to imitate or otherwise react to a significant change around him. Which Marcus pretty much sort of, like, doesn't do a whole lot emotions-wise until something happens to him or happens to the group. And tends to, like, follow along with charismatic personalities. And, like, the player chooses it. I don't think the half-giant, like, actively, like, today I will be lawful. It's just something that they do. And so the experience stuff sort of reflects, hey, if you follow along with those kinds of lines, then that's in line with the way that half-giants are supposed to be portrayed, and you should get a reward for that. Then treasure, custom to that. Magical items. God, there's so much great stuff in here. Some fun stuff for combat. There's sort of a nice little look. Let's see. Remember, we were just looking at a gladiator scene before. And this isn't like leaps and bounds better. Actually, this has a little bit more like scenery and stuff like that. But just like the general look of the characters is just so much more interesting to me. They're a lot more dynamic. There's, like, it's a lot easier to read what each individual is doing. And it goes into a little bit of detail of, like, here's some interesting gladiator ideas, and here's some encounter ideas. Oh, Dungeon Master material. The subject included in this chapter are pertinent to balanced gameplay, whether da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. Yeah, so this is for how to manage spellcasters and time. They go through this whole thing, and again, it's kind of a pain to, like, incorporate, but they've got this whole system for here's how years are tracked in the world. They've got sort of this matched pair of tables that work in concert with one another. It's great. It's just terrific. And, you know, you can totally imagine, right? I've been picking this up in 7th grade and going, this is... Look at all this. Look at how much stuff there is in here. Look at... What I really appreciate, and appreciated then, I think, is really feeling like, okay, these people really, really, really felt like this world is special, and we should really think about ways to make this world feel special and build on that specialness. Yes, absolutely. The background stuff does a great, great job. So that is the rule book. And then the real good stuff, the absolute best stuff, is in here. The Wanderer's Chronicle. This is basically the lore book. This is what has all of the information about the fiction of the Dark Sun world, as penned by the master adventurer, the Wanderer himself. It has, like, a full history of the world. It has a timeline of everything that's gone on. I'm not going to dwell too much on a whole lot of this stuff, because this might give away some stuff for the overall adventure, but certainly there's probably some stuff that we can see in here. It goes into the Sorcerer Kings and where they came from and the different races and how they factor in all these different kinds of things. And it starts exploring each and every single one of those places across those gigantic maps that we were looking at. Let me see if there's some particularly good maps and stuff like that. Here's art probably we've seen about as much maps as we've seen, but this is a merchant caravan. It's being drawn by a couple of makelots. Makelots are these gigantic plated lizards the size of dinosaurs. You can tell that there's all these little people sort of gathered around. There's just this gigantic tank of a thing. It's 3 stories tall. They're pretty close to turtles. There's so much good stuff in here. There's so many interesting sort of wildlife creations and stuff like that. Guide to each of the different kind of city-states and stuff like that. Different sort of castes and different places that you might be able to travel. Let's see if we've got somewhere that's kind of relevant to what we're doing. Here's a map of Nibene. Look at that. That looks pretty familiar, right? Not bad. Not bad. Got some more good art. Here's some more of those wasp riders that we were looking at. Coming in hot on a fighter riding along on an Inix, fighting off some Thrycreen raiders. We've seen a few of those before, not too many. Thrycreen are a lot of fun. Oh, and then the Jagged Cliffs region. Here's this entire chapter on this entire northern section that's completely untouched. And because it's untouched, it has all this stuff about, well, like, if you're gonna go there, here's some of the stuff that you should know about, and here's some of the wildlife that you should be aware of, and that kind of thing. Here's some more Thrycreen. That's some good stuff. There's some stuff out on the savannah, out in these gigantic grasslands where we haven't gone yet, but maybe one day. Maybe one day. Yeah, more Thrycreen stuff. All these places, all these terrific. Here's sort of a good druid kind of setting. Someone at a grove, communing with a nature spirit, perhaps learning that they're supposed to be king and to go back to Pride Rock or something like that. Maybe. But they don't just have that. They've got this bizarre stretch to the south where there's this obsidian plain and all these dead cities across it. They've got all these new spots that they've sort of detailed in the Silt Sea, and there's they've just taken every section of the world and come up with more and more detail. And then there's some monsters. This is a good little montage here. So here we've got some of the more domestic animals that you'd see. Sorry, I'm having a bad time. There we go. So you've got an Erdlu. There's a little man. And there is a Kank, which are the ants that people ride on sometimes. And there's an Inix. There's those big lizards that people ride. The Terrans had those as pack beasts. Cade has one, actually. He can sort of summon and dismiss it like a WoW mount. And there's a Makelot. I like how it's got those kind of chameleon pointed eyes. That's pretty cool. Man, I need to get back to drawing monsters. I haven't done that in a while. And hi, Dom. What's left in the box? Well, there's an invitation to use your head. 10 great reasons to join the RPGA network. But what is the RPGA network? Well, actually, I don't know. I'm not sure. Oh, maybe it says here on the back. So clearly, it's probably just Role Playing Game Association, right? New worlds to explore. only RPGA members are eligible to play in these exclusive gaming worlds: Raven's Bluff, the Living City, Malatra, the Living Jungle, and Virtual Seattle, and so on and so forth. And then on the back, they got sort of some teases. Looks like this is something to do, sort of a incorporation with Polyhedron magazine, which is bigger once upon a time. Virtual Seattle sounds like Living Greyhawk, but in Shadowrun. I imagine all of this is sort of kind of like Living Greyhawk, which is sort of, you can play in adventures. No, I think it's actually Shadowrun. I think it's, yeah, check it out. I think it's actually like an aspect of Shadowrun. Bink. If you sign up and you're playing in a Virtual Seattle adventure, then your group of runners is doing something in the game, which is actually in the same game world as everyone else that's playing in Virtual Seattle. So it's sort of like, it's almost like an MMO by mail, where the things that you do might affect sort of a global storyline or something like that. And there might be like particular events where people can meet up and play in shared games and stuff like that. It sounds interesting. I've never... The constraints of technology back when it was big sort of led me to be kind of disillusioned with the idea, because I think that... I've always been more interested in, like, digital implementations of that, because it's so much easier for people in widely different locations to collaborate. But there you go. Like what we're doing right now. Where do you live? I don't know. I live right here. I think that's it. I think that's everything that's in this box. But look at all that stuff. Whoever thought of that and sold it and got it to happen. And it's in like mint condition. Look at that. Like, I'm not a stickler for that, but that's really nice. Cool. So yeah, I really like it. I'm happy to have gotten it. I'm excited. I'm excited for this coming year. We've been playing D&D together for more than a year, but the end of January marks our first year streaming it. I believe the 26th? Is that Tuesday? Yes, Tuesday the 26th. That'll be our one-year streamversary. And lots of fun stuff planned for that and for the rest of the year. Cool. Thank you guys so much for hanging out. This was a lot of fun, actually. I have tons of Dark Sun stuff sitting around, so if people are interested in seeing like more of this like really old stuff and like seeing what comes with it and like what excites me about a particular product, then I'd be happy to continue doing like just one-off streams here and there. So if you're interested and you're not already following along, maybe follow along on Twitter or Facebook and let me know what you think. I will be back here tomorrow. Tomorrow is board game night. We'll be playing our next episode of Pandemic Legacy. Ferret Dev will be there, Lobos will be there, Fieldy will be there. A lot of plans for Dungeons & Dragons this year, but a lot of plans for board games, too. This is going to be a fine, fine year for board games. So if you like board games and you're interested in seeing some more of them, tune in. It's going to be great. And then next week, assuming I don't suddenly get sick again, we'll be back on a Tuesday to play more Dungeons & Dragons. Maybe we'll be back to drawing some maps and stuff on Monday, but we will see. Still working out schedule and stuff like that. Lots of stuff going on. But yeah, thank you so much for hanging out. This was, I got this and I was like, I was gonna pour through all this stuff just one at a time anyway, and I was like, I should just do a video of this for fun. And I'm glad that I did, and I'm glad that you all enjoyed it. Thank you all. Yeah, I'm gonna quit babbling now. Have a great night. See you next time.